Good morning again. Apologies for interrupting your visiting with each other, but we want to begin our program. A couple of things I wanted to just mention to you briefly. If you look at the printed program, I would love for you to note November 10th, that is our next Nashville Business Breakfast featuring Curtis Stevens of LP. We would love to have you there. I'm sure our next event will be back in Allen Arena, but watch for details on location, same time, but November 10th, we'd love to have you join us for that. Another thing I did want to mention is there are more door prizes coming throughout the day. Our friends with the Titans have brought some more door prizes for us, and so be listening for your name as the morning progresses. And it is 5 days until kickoff. We're excited about that. And for those like me among us who are the eternal optimist with the Titans, I know this is the year, so it will be good. So we're grateful to have John and Mike with us this morning. It's going to be a great morning hearing from them. One of the other things that I am always privileged to do on mornings like this is to introduce someone who will lead our invocation. And this morning, in just a minute, I'm going to ask Scott Tillman to come to the stage. Scott is the head coach of Lipscomb Academy's football team. Before Scott comes up, I do just want to share one thing. I have a 32-year-old son and a 28-year-old son. And they both played football on this field right out here. And when I think about all the memories that come from the things that they learned, the things that they took with them from that experience, there's a lot of memories, so many memories that flood my mind when I start thinking about those years of just watching them. But I know Scott in particular may be proud of this, but the one moment that always comes to my mind when I think about the highlights that just replay over and over and over again in my head from those 8 years of watching my sons play varsity football. And my younger son, Burton, was a defensive player. He played cornerback, and Scott at that time was Coach McAdams' defensive coordinator. And we were playing one of, really our rival at the time for region championship, and it would be the team, it was Giles County, Bo Wallace, if you remember that name. Bo Wallace was the leader of that team. That would be the team that would keep us from getting to the state championship if we couldn't get past them. But I'll never forget, there was one moment when we were on defense and a game we were having right out here on the field. And the runner for Giles County came through the line, pretty wide opening, and one of our defensive players just made the perfect play and knocked the ball loose. And my son happened to be in the right place at the right time. And he scooped the ball up from about the 35-yard line, ran it in the end zone, which is a privilege for a defensive player. But what I will remember most about that play and what it told me about what our coaches here at Lipscomb teach our kids is before he even picked the ball up, there was this line of purple jerseys that was forming. And he had, and it was perfectly planned, perfectly organized, and it happened in an instant. And there was this wall of jerseys that helped escort him into the end zone. And I guess of all the things, when I think of Coach McAdams here at Lipscomb, and now Coach Tillman, as much as my sons learned about football, they learned so much more about life and what to do and who to be. I think that's what we all want for our children and our grandchildren. But it is a privilege to be here this morning and introduce this man to you. So would you join me in welcoming Scott Tillman, head football coach at Lipscomb.
We'd like to welcome you to Lipscomb Academy. To our athletic complex. You are in our brand new McAdams Athletic Center. It was opened on Thursday. Its namesake, of course, a Hall of Fame coach, Glenn McAdams, did an amazing job. He's in the Tennessee Hall of Fame as one of the all-time winningest coaches. But Lipscomb, if you don't know Lipscomb, it's much more than wins and losses. We're an intentionally Christian institution that cares more about what kind of husbands and fathers our boys are going to be than the wins and the score on the scoreboard. And so we're thankful you're here. And I told John this morning, we're so proud of the Titans because we think they're doing such a great job of picking character guys that represent our community so well. John, we try to say we're not as much into wins and losses, but we sure like to win. And I remember a time back in 1995 where we traveled to your home city, John, Union City. We won 7-0. Let's pray together. Father God, I thank you for this day. I thank you, Father, for loving us. I thank you for the opportunities that you bring every day with life. Father, I thank you for walking along with us in this life. Father, I thank you for football. I thank you for sports. And I thank you, Father, that gives us an opportunity to teach. It's a platform, Father, for us to teach our young men and our women how to be selfless, how to be a part of a team. Father, I thank you for the Titans and the way they represent this community. I pray that you bless them this season, you keep them free from injury. Thank you for this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Coach. And on behalf of Lipscomb University, I am very, very privileged to welcome you this morning. And Coach, I believe all that stuff about character, but I too think winning is important. You started Friday night, keep it up, we got a whole season to go. When people ask me if you have football at Lipscomb, I say, well, we play Division I, and we don't have football, and yet we do have football. We can walk a block from our main campus on Friday night and see outstanding high school football. We appreciate all of you who join us in that. I want to thank and want you to have the opportunity to thank all those that once again were up at 3 or 4 this morning and cooked our food and set up our arena and did the audiovisual and all of that. Let's thank them for providing this wonderful place for us. A school like Lipscomb is led by a board of trustees, and we don't often have trustees from out of town with us, but today we have the chairman of our board, David Scobie, former president of AT&T in the Southeast, lives in Atlanta, but comes to Lipscomb almost every week. Would you please welcome our board chair, David Scobie? And we do welcome you to this facility. I was actually in here last week. I threw my first pass, and it was a completion. I then dropped the pass thrown back to me, and I ended my football career thereafter. But underneath you is this wonderful turf and all the excitement and the energy that people will have in this temperature-controlled facility day in and day out to practice athletically, football and lots of other sports as well. We're doing something special at Lipscomb this year, and that is celebrating our 125th anniversary. I don't know how to go back to 1891 and even begin to imagine what it was like when this guy who had, as we say, nothing more than faith and a farm, decided he would start a school. And he did not start a school to train preachers. He started a school to train, and get this, men and women in the very first class for their careers, but also to take a sense of character and faith into their lives. He was a visionary. He was someone who was out of the box. He was looking at Nashville and saying, we need to have an institution where people graduate and are concerned about others. They're concerned about the poor. They're concerned about those who need to be educated. They're concerned about, and the list would go on and on. And so he, in his humble but visionary way, decided to start that school. The year was 1891. From there, I wonder sometimes if he could come back, what would he say today? If he could somehow be transported from those humble beginnings downtown in a small little building and come back 125 years later, well, as the president, I wonder if he'd be pleased with what we've done. He certainly would be astounded. He would be astounded at the cost of education. He would be astounded that it takes $160 million a year to run this institution. And yet I think he'd be pleased that 30 or 40 million of those dollars go to some of the poorest students in Tennessee and other states, giving them an opportunity for education they never would have otherwise had. I think he'd be surprised that students come from 48 states and 57 foreign countries, because his first student body would have come from a few miles of that humble building. And yet he would be so thrilled that we are a welcoming community, not only this university, but Nashville is a welcoming community. And we can celebrate along with other institutions over 100,000 college students here. He'd be a little tweaked, I think, that so much of higher education today is focused on careers. Go to school, get a job. Because he would want people to have a much broader sense of their life's purpose. But he'd be pleased with the 900 students who went on mission trips to 25 nations last year. He'd be pleased with the service that's done in the city of Nashville. He'd be pleased with facts like every day Lipscomb University teachers teach 56,000 students in our public schools. He'd be pleased with that. I think he'd wonder about how our society has changed and how things in some sense have become so much more secular, but he would be appreciative of an institution that even in today's world says faith is important. There are some fundamental questions about life that students deserve to wrestle with and to seek to answer. I think he'd be really paused by the sense of competition between colleges and universities. Every day we get up and say, who are the five schools we most compete with? And that list is Pepperdine and Baylor and Samford and Belmont and Vanderbilt. And he'd be a little alarmed at that competition, but he would be pleased, I think, that along the way, even his institution has recognition that his understanding of what it seeks to do. Bloomberg named our undergraduate business program the top in Tennessee. Christian Colleges Online just last week named our biology program number one out of 125 Christian universities in the country. And the list goes on and on. He would be humble, but I think he would be pleased. He would be paused that race has become the issue it is once again, that we as a culture and a society have not figured that one out, especially in the backdrop of his own family, where in 1834 his father took Lipscomb and his siblings and his mother and their slaves from Nashville, Tennessee, up into Ohio and Indiana, seeking to free them. Because it was illegal to do that in Tennessee. That was a costly trip. David Lipscomb's mother died on that trip, as did one of his sisters. He would be paused to look around Nashville and see what this great city has become. He couldn't have imagined it, but he would be thrilled that there are various aspects of it doing extraordinarily well, from Titan football to a wonderful concert venue to an art a museum to the business that you all are a part of churning along. He'd be, I think, particularly pleased that our nickname for many years has been the Athens of the South, as 23 universities and colleges work with the business community and are a part of what we seek to be. So 125 years later, we can't talk to him. We can't interview him like is going to happen in just a moment. But we do seek to look back into that history and do our very best to walk it forward in ways that he, too, would be pleased. And so we come to a wonderful program today as we think about this athletic facility and we focus on the beginning of a football season and our local team, the Titans. I want to introduce to you Mike Keith, who will do the interview this morning, and also introduce to you our other special guest. The winner of the Edward Morrow Award, the Tennessee Sportscaster of the Year 11 times, and now in his 19th season as the voice of the Titans, would you please welcome Mike Keith.
It's an honor to be here. Thank you to the Nashville Business Journal and to everyone at Lipscomb, and congratulations on this fantastic facility. We're pleased to help, in a small way, christen it and introduce it to this entire community. Our most exciting offseason ever was the offseason that followed the 1998 campaign, the 99 offseason. And that only makes sense because we had changed our name. So we unveiled a logo, we unveiled uniforms, we unveiled St. Thomas Sports Park, we unveiled what is now known as Nissan Stadium, we drafted Javon Kearse, and best of all, we went to the Super Bowl and had a Music City miracle along the way. That was a great offseason that led into a great season. At that time, John Robinson was a graduate assistant at Nichols State who had not yet turned 23 years old. The last 17 years have been eventful for all of us, for John Robinson especially. He stayed at Nichols State, became a full-time member of their coaching staff, and then was hired as a scout with the New England Patriots. Won 3 Super Bowls with the Patriots, worked his way up the ranks to the director of college scouting, and then had a chance to move on to a bigger role with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers as their director of player personnel. When we interviewed him for our job in January, Amy Adams Strunk said she knew within 10 minutes of the interview starting that we had our man. And I think from this very exciting offseason, you would agree that she is absolutely right. Ladies and gentlemen, a big game week welcome to our general manager, your general manager, John Robinson.
Thank you, Mike.
You couldn't quite top 99, but you were pretty close. It's been a lot of fun.
It has been a lot of fun. Before we get started, Coach, it was not 95. I was gone. I graduated in 94. So had we played you guys back then, I think probably would have been a little different.
We may let you settle that outside later.
Yeah. We're not going to do any board drills. We're both too old, Coach.
All right. So the excitement of this offseason, you had the number one pick. You traded it. You traded for DeMarco Murray. You've drafted what appears to be a fantastic class to this point. Really excited about everything we're seeing them do. I think one of the most impressive stats is right now you have 63 players on your team, 53 on the regular roster, 10 on the practice squad. 61 of them were with you in training camp. And if you add in guys who've signed with other teams, active rosters or practice squads, that number roughly around 70. So 70 of your 90 our NFL players, that's a pretty good group you had in camp.
Yeah, I mean, we set out back in January talking about the type of football team we wanted to be and tough, dependable team first. You guys have heard that mantra about a million times from me. And we wanted to be really, really competitive. We wanted the guys to come in and have a certain skill set, but also have a mindset and have a makeup as a player that they wanted to make themselves better. You know, some of those rookies that we signed post-draft, you know, I really thought that, you know, they would be competitive, but I didn't know what type of future they actually had in the NFL. But to their credit, you know, their characters, you know, it showed through, and those guys are on other practice squads now.
Yeah, you've got some guys who are playing other places. You can't keep them all. You understand that, but you want to have a guy who's in there who's going to be an NFL player, and you clearly did that.
Yes. Yeah, we were pleasantly surprised at how training camp went and how we came out, and then really excited in the preseason. You know, a lot of people say the preseason games don't mean a whole lot, but anytime you put the ball down and the ref blows the whistle, you want to win the game, and we came away with 3 of those.
You have the job that everybody in sports wants. Everybody wants to pick the players. We all have fantasy drafts, and we all think, man, if I was drafting, I would take this guy right here. So we know about that part of your job, but here's something that I want you to get into for our audience. The general manager's role overall and what you do. We know you pick the players. We know you're into personnel evaluation. But who reports to you? Who works directly with you? How does your organizational structure go within the team?
Yeah, I quickly learned, and I've said this before, that the term general, it's a very, very broad term. And when I'm handling this something that needs to be replaced, or we need to order this bag, or I generally term that I'm generally managing right now. I'm not actually watching football, I'm generally managing. I handle basically all of the football operations.
That's all right, we'll get that.
Fumble.
That's all right.
I handle all of the football relations, or football operations, aside from the coaching. Obviously, I pick the players, but the equipment, the video, the training and the medical staff, I work with Steve Underwood, who our president, who oversees the business side, and obviously Coach Malarkey. You know, we all work together, and it truly is a team. You know, the team is more than just the players. It's community relations, it's marketing, it's ticket sales. And we all have our part. We all have our own role within the organization. Now, inevitably, throughout the course of the day, I'm sure many of you guys get it as well. You get the, can I get 2 minutes? And those 2 minutes add up to, you know, an hour and a half out throughout the course of the day. One of the things I've had to learn to do is delegate, you know, and I spend most of my time with the player personnel department and evaluating teams, getting ready for the draft. But you still have to carve out those 2 minutes occasionally to work with the other part of the organization.
How much time do you spend with Coach Malarkey and the other members of the coaching staff?
Generally, a lot of time, a lot with Mike in a one-on-one setting, just talking about the plan for the week, especially in preseason, talking about roster evaluations. I sit in with the coaches the day after the games and watch the film with them. Not to suggest any plays, but I want to know how the coaches think those players are performing, you know, who's having mental errors, who really did a good job, so that I can make the best decision about the players on the team. So that's post game. So on Monday morning, I'll sit with Coach Malarkey and the offensive staff, and then briefly with Coach LeBeau, just to kind of recap the game. But it's general conversations throughout the course of the day as you pass them in the hall. Hey, how's so-and-so doing? Hey, how's this guy doing? Because I want to stay up to date with how they're performing, not necessarily on the field all the time, but how they're doing in the classroom as well.
You came in, you made some changes, but you kept a majority of the people who were in place. From a management standpoint, why did you decide to do that?
Well, I mean, I had known a lot of the guys that were on the personnel staff, to speak specifically to that. And, you know, I thought that, hey, let's see if these guys are coachable. Let's see what type of value they have, and let me evaluate those guys and if they can buy into philosophically what we want to be about, how we're going to evaluate players. And we might have two, three, four great personnel guys on the staff now. So give those guys a chance before making, you know, before rushing to judgment.
You spent time with the Buccaneers, but I want to go back to your 12 years with the Patriots. Obviously, the most stable franchise in the NFL. In recent years, the most successful franchise in the NFL. What do you take organizationally from the Patriots that you have directly implemented with the Titans?
Really, the standard, no matter what your role is on the football team, whether you're the scouting assistant or in my role or the head coach or the fourth trainer, everybody has to have the same mindset, to have pride about their job, to do their job, not to steal their slogan, but do whatever they're responsible for to the best of their ability, and know that they are a valued member of our football team. And we can only go as far as the entire organization is willing to go. There was a lot of pressure put on us in New England to perform our respective jobs, and, you know, I never wanted to let Bill down. I never wanted there to be a player in the draft that slipped through the cracks that we didn't know about. So I worked extra, extra, extra to make sure that I wasn't going to disappoint the guy. And that's the similar mindset I'm trying to implement, and Mike's trying to implement there, is go the extra mile, and that's going to put us in a position where we need to be.
We see Bill Belichick as the Patriots coach. We don't know much about him because he doesn't give much away as a coach. But working for him as a manager, as somebody who has control over all football operations, what about Bill should we know that we don't?
He is extremely attentive to detail. Like he's actually funny. He's good to sit in a room with and converse with. He's got some, you know, shrewd little jokes he'll tell here and there. I can kind of make him smile sometimes. But he's asking me about, just pick a year, the 2010 draft. So let's just say we finished the 2010 draft. He wanted to meet the very next week about guys for the 2011 draft. So he's always thinking ahead. He's trying to stay one step ahead of the competition. And I knew that I better know those prospects for the next year's draft, even though we just got finished. I mean, I'm wanting to exhale for a second. And he's ready to keep forging ahead. So it's really that approach that was really impressive to me.
Talk football philosophy. We know every team, whether it's Coach Tillman's team or anybody in football at any level, you got to have a quarterback. Outside of a quarterback, where do you start? What are the building blocks for your organization that you knew coming in here you had to get straight?
Yeah, I think when I interviewed, one of the things that I talked about, in order for that quarterback to be successful, he can't throw it if he's laying on his back. So we wanted to really bolster the offensive line and protect Marcus. We made an acquisition. We signed Ben Jones in free agency and then positioned ourselves to take Jack Conklin there in the first round. And then, one of the other guys he's had a really good preseason, and everybody thinks we just hand him the football, and when we do hand it to him, he's pretty dang good with it. But both DeMarco Murray and Derrick Henry are outstanding at pass protection. They do a really good job of stepping up and stoning blitzers. Don't allow those guys to get to Marcus. And when you keep those guys in the game, both Derrick and DeMarco, strategically, not to get too far in the weeds with the X's and O's here, Coach, but generally the defense is going to keep their base personnel in, so the guys that can tackle the runners. And then that allows us to be able to throw the ball, because there's potentially a mismatch with Delanie Walker on a linebacker who's really more of a run player than he is a coverage guy. So I think it started with the line and protecting Marcus. That was really the crux of what we wanted to do in the offseason.
Supply and demand. Only so many players. 31 other teams want them as well. There's a salary cap. All of those things factor in. How do you decide when picking a player or when acquiring a player, it's better to do it through the draft or it's better to do it through free agency?
Yeah, that's really a meeting we'll have in February. By that point, you'll know when, free agency, we'll have our free agency board kind of set up, and then we'll have our draft board, I would say, pretty much set by February. You'll have to tweak it a little bit. And you basically just look at the positions. If you're really in need of a tight end, and it looks like the depth at tight end is good in the draft, but maybe the supply at tight end and free agency isn't very good, well, then you obviously know that you're going to have to go and draft a player. So you may have to sign another player in free agency that doesn't really have depth in the draft. So you balance both of those boards back and forth, and you try to strategically put yourself in position, again, without compromising the integrity of the team when it comes to free agency. Because there's a little bit more dollars and cents involved, obviously a lot more, in free agency than there is the draft.
All right, let's talk free agency. NBA, I signed LeBron James. I'm the Cleveland Cavaliers. I'm right back in the finals. I have a good team. Why is NFL free agency so much more tricky than NBA free agency or free agency in Major League Baseball?
I think generally it's just a different sport. The 11 guys now in baseball and basketball, you're relying on your teammates. But if there's a gaping hole at one position, it's going to show more in football. So I think with free agency, we rely a lot on the college background, the information, because those guys, they were probably drafted by their other team, and they might have been there their entire rookie year. And a lot of times, free agency is a frenzy when midnight strikes. And those guys are signed without you ever actually talking to them. We did that with Ben Jones. Ben Jones showed up, and we hadn't even talked to him prior to us agreeing to a contract. So there's a lot of unknown factor with those players. So that's where we really rely on our, dating back to our college reports on the player about his character, his makeup, what's his home life like. You obviously have some discussion with the agent to try to get a little bit more of a gauge about the guy as a guy. Because, as Coach and I were talking, it's as important about the makeup of the player as well. Is he going to be philosophically what we want to be? Is he going to have the mindset that we're looking for in football players? You can see the skill set on the field, but is he going to have what it takes inside and as a person as well?
What do you look for in the makeup? We know that height, weight, speed, all the football stuff. What's the makeup all about, though? What's the key in that for you to want a guy, whether he's a free agent or he's a draftable player?
Yeah, really, outside of their faith and their family, is football the third most important thing in their life? Are they willing to do whatever it takes to be the best football person, player, coach, whatever it may be, outside of their faith and their family? Football has to be at least third there. And if you've got 53 guys on your roster that football is very, very important to them, and they're driven to win, they're driven to succeed, they're willing to stay out after practice, they're willing to come in early and meet with the coach, then you got a pretty good chance of winning in this league.
You have a guy who takes care of the salary cap for you. His name's Ven Marino. Salary cap is $155.27 million this year for all 53 of your players in your practice squad, anybody you put on IR. Why do you have a specific guy to handle that, and how much do you rely on Ven Marino?
Yeah, Ven is a ninja with numbers. He knows the ins and outs of all of that. I have a basic understanding of the salary cap. We have to spend 89% of our salaries have to count towards the cap. But there's a lot of rules and regulations and stipulations when you sign a player, you know, his roster, his signing bonus prorates out over the course of his contract, but if you cut him, it accelerates back. So that's the delegation part. So that's Vin's baby. He knows contracts. He does most of the negotiations with the agents, except when I have to step in and fire three fastballs and try to get us out. But he is a very, very important part of what we do.
What's your role with the media? What's the general manager? I'm wondering.
Bill said don't talk to him.
Well, so. I know that's where you come from. That's why we're so surprised you're as engaging as you are, truthfully.
Yeah, no. I try to be myself. They have a job to do, and I'm very understanding of that. And I'm willing to help them when it doesn't compromise anything as it relates to the football team. And I've told them that. You know, when I got named GM, hey, listen, I'm here to help you guys. I want to be as transparent as possible. But I will never do anything that jeopardizes the football team.
What's the best advice you've gotten about dealing with the media?
Don't talk to them.
Don't talk to them? All right. So we've all seen the movies and we've seen TV. We've seen Jerry Maguire. And we know that agents and general managers supposedly have very adversarial type relationships. How accurate a portrayal is that? When you talk to an agent, is it adversarial?
Depending on who the agent is. No, it's generally healthy conversations. I know a lot of them. They're working for their player, their client. I'm working for the football team. In the end, we just try to. It's no different than buying a car. I mean, it's maybe a little different than buying a car, but you're just trying to find a happy medium about, hey, we think your player is worth this. We're willing to make concessions this way. If you're willing to make concessions. You generally try to keep the discussions productive and heading in the right direction. So I don't really have any enemies in the agent world. I have had some interesting discussions with some of them. Let's just leave it at that.
You do know, too, that many people in this room judge your job based on the movie Draft Day with Kevin Costner.
Oh, yeah, I've gotten that.
Have you seen the movie?
No, I have not.
Okay. Well, in the movie, some of the most interesting conversations that Kevin Costner has would be with other general managers. As a matter of fact, he calls one a pancake-eating blankety-blank at one point. It's really not very nice. Does that really go on?
No comment.
Oh, come on. That doesn't really happen, does it?
No. Generally speaking, you don't. I mean, we have proven that we're open for business. We're willing to wheel and deal if it makes sense for our football team. So, again, I've tried to keep, much like with the agents, not comparing general managers to agents.
Sure.
Try to keep those relationships open and productive.
Can you have a relationship with players?
Yes, you can. But I have gone on record several times about saying that in my role, I have to be void of sentimentality. I have to look at everything as what's best for the football team. I want the players to know that I'm there for them. I've told every single one of them my door is always open. If you ever want to come and talk to me, except don't call and come up and ask for more money. If you want to take a pay cut, come on up. Just kidding. but in the end, I'm charged with making the tough decisions Sometimes we have to move on from players when it doesn't make the most sense for the football team, and you wanna get to know them on a personal level and know that you care about them and that you're there for them, but it's a fine line. You have to just be careful.
All right, here's the $64,000 question. How much time do you spend discussing things with the owner, the controlling owner, the ownership group?
Yeah, it's over the weekend, it was text back and forth and then a couple phone calls. I usually, try to touch base a couple times a week and keep her informed on what's going on. She'll call me if she has any questions. Her and Kenneth have been outstanding in talking back and forth through things as it relates to the football team. She gets football. She's extremely, extremely passionate about the success of this franchise and the direction that we're heading. And I tell you, I couldn't ask for a better, group, a better family to work for.
All right, so I've written down, we've kind of gone through who all you have contact with. The scouts and the personnel people, the head coach and his assistants, the players and their agents. We didn't mention NFL officials in New York who you have to talk to.
Text with them.
Yep.
Bad calls.
Other GMs, Vin Marino about the salary cap, college coaches at times as you're working on scouting, the media and your own media staff, the people who work on the business side of the organization, another part of your job where you have to stay in touch, the travel staff, the equipment staff, the facility staff, most importantly, the ownership group. So how do you balance what and who gets your time, and how do you still stay sane and spend time with your wife and daughters? Because it seems like you could work 24/7, 7 days a week.
I've got a huge, huge hat rack in my office. And I just take one hat off. But I'm just kidding. It's you're right. I've learned to delegate. I've learned to put the pressure on Ryan Cowden, who's our director of player personnel. Hey, meet with the scouts and go through this, and then come back to me and let's talk through it. Trust people to do their jobs. Empower them to do them, and then hold them accountable to do them the way you want to do it. I'm fairly open. I don't mind talking, and in the end, I just want this franchise, this football team to win. So whatever I got to do, if it's 15 hours, if it's 18 hours, I did reintroduce myself to my family on Sunday afternoon. My daughters went from this to this, it seemed like in 7 months. I'm having a blast doing it. I'm really having fun.
Hey, think about this. You're from Union City. From Obion County, you're back here, you're general manager of the NFL team that came into being as you were playing college football. You're 5 days away from this really happening. You've put this roster together with help, but you're the GM. I mean, this is yours. This has got to be, as you sit here and look at this group today and think about January 18th when you introduced yourself via your press conference, this has got to be incredibly special.
Yeah, goosebumps, a lot of goosebumps. Just can't put into words how fun it's really been the last 7 months. I still get chills when I round the corner and see the fireball on the wall. To be home and doing what I'm doing, it's been great. It's really been good.
This is going to be a fun year, isn't it?
It's going to be a heck of a lot of fun this year.
Yeah. John Robinson, your general manager, taking time to be with us. Thank you so much.
Thank you guys for coming out. Tighten up.
Mike, if you join me for just a
second. I'll stay with you right here.
Awesome. We've got some wonderful door prizes to give away. The Titans and Lipscomb Academy have been generous. John, thank you for bringing us into the mind of our general manager and for all that it takes to be successful. Let's go ahead and jump to these door prizes real quick. We've got some great stuff back here, Mike.
All right. I'm as far as I can get with this. Is that a Delaney Walker signed football?
We've got a Delaney Walker signed football.
That's
Tell
it.
Us a little, Mike, about
Delaney Walker, Pro Bowl tight end, set a franchise record last year with catches for a tight end and yards for a tight end. Number 82, one of our very best players, one of our very most popular players.
Good deal. And this morning's winner of the Delaney Walker football from Avison Young, Tammy Brace Turnup Speed. Tammy, where are you? Stand
yeah.
up. There you
Congratulations.
Are.
Congratulations.
Welcome. Congratulations.
Well, I think that's Lipscomb Academy. Good
All
stuff.
All right, we're going Lipscomb Academy. Great little workout shirt here. The winner of that from Karina is Nate Miller. Nate, stand on up for us. All right, Mike. Someone who we expect to carry the ball many times.
You get a football signed. Is it Derrick Henry?
A Derrick Henry signed football.
All I need to say is 2015 Heisman Trophy winner. We think he and DeMarco Murray are going to run the rock a lot for the Titans this year. But, I mean, obviously, because he's a Heisman Trophy winner, it is a collector's item. By the way, we're the first NFL team to have back-to-back Heisman Trophy winners on the roster in 25 years. Marcus Mariota obviously won it. The Detroit Lions had Barry Sanders and Andre Ware in back-to-back years. We're the first team since them to have back-to-back Heisman Trophy winners.
Excellent. And the winner of the Derrick Henry autographed football from North Highland, Todd Nisbet. Todd, where are you? All right. Okay, let's jump back. A Lipscomb Academy pull over to where Friday night at Overton, right, Coach? Friday night at Overton, the winner of this Lipscomb Academy pullover from Poplar Hill Realty, Wyatt Rampey. Wyatt, where are you? All right. Okay, last but not least, Mike, we've got a signed football from this morning's speaker, John Robinson. Tell us just a little bit about how the Titans have been different since he's come on board.
How long have you got? He's done so many great things. I think the guy's just 40 years old, which is really amazing to see him come in. And he and Coach Malarkey and several others have really helped change our culture, not just out here, not just with players, but within the building. We are as excited as you are for this season because we want these men, the coaches, our staff, our players to do well. We like this group a lot, and we really feel like we're going to be successful. So I was thrilled to have a chance to be here with him today, kind of let him tell his story, because what those guys do is unreal.
Thank you much. And the winner of the John Robinson signed football this morning from the Nashville Chamber, Rita McDonald. Rita, where are you? And would you join me in thanking our interviewer this morning and special guest, Mike Keith.
Thank you.
As we close, I want to take you to a moment I had Friday night as I was, for the first time, out on the balcony overlooking our field and watching the Lipscomb Academy Mustangs take it to the Clarksville Northwest. I have no idea what their mascot is. Flying what? Vikings, okay. As I was out there on that platform, it was a moment of great personal satisfaction as I looked out across our stands and out into the plaza and saw the Lipscomb Academy community gather. And I recognized something that perhaps you all know as you've been involved in institutions and other things, that football is a great thing for bringing a community together. There's almost nothing like it that will bring school communities and even larger communities in terms of cities around the country, but football is a great unifier. And yet, as I looked at that, I was more inspired by what I saw on the field and the unifying force that existed within the lines in the game of football. As I looked out on that field, you saw student athletes that were out there competing fiercely against each other. They represented a multitude of races. They represented a multitude of religions. They came from different backgrounds. They had different socioeconomic situations. And yet they were unified on Friday night as they were competing together on the field. They were able to embrace the diversity that they represented, and they were unified for the single purpose of pursuing their dream of playing football on Friday night. We've heard already this morning about a lot of the lessons that football allows us to give to student athletes, and yet perhaps for us this morning, they give us a lesson as well. Perhaps it's between the lines when we watch kids play football. Perhaps there's a lesson for us that says we can overcome our diversity, we can be unified, and we can together work towards a singular purpose of being able to pursue our dreams, having the opportunity in our community for everyone to pursue those dreams. Perhaps that is a gift that football gives us. And so as a business community, it's not inappropriate for us to gather and to think a little bit about football. It's not only an important economic driver in this town, but it's also something that we can learn from as well. And so as we leave here this morning, I leave you with the words of perhaps the most famous football coach, Vince Lombardi, who said this: "Leaders are not born, they are made, and they are made just like anything else, through hard work. That's the price we have to pay to achieve that or any goal." This fall, as we set goals for not only the Titans, but for our community, perhaps we can place our unity at a very high place as we think about our goals. And I ask that each of us, as we leave here, commit to the hard work that will be required for us to achieve that unity. We will see you back November 10th for the next Nashville Business Breakfast. Go in peace. We're dismissed.